Hey everybody, welcome to the Retirement Railroad 2.0 special edition. And as always, we are live from
Oklahoma, where the wind comes sweeping down the plain, and the waving wheat can sure smell sweet when the wind comes right behind the rain.
Gotta do it, guys. I just gotta do it. And joining me this morning is, of course, John, C&EI. Hey, John, how you doing?
Good morning.
And
ready,
of course,
barbecue.
Yeah, and of course, yeah. John is live from
Rocky Top. You'll always be home sweet home to me. Good old Rocky Top, Rocky Top, Tennessee, Rocky Top, Tennessee.
And of course, Jason will be our man in the middle. Will be joining us in about half an hour or so. He goes on lunch and gets settled, and hopefully he can pop in. He's got the link. And of course, Jason is from the middle state between Tennessee and Oklahoma, of course, Arkansas.
And I'm riding on the Cotton Belt Railroad line, in the pigeon rolling rhythm and noise.
All right. So anyway, today we're looking at firing up one way or another the Retirement Railroad 2.0, and should be hopefully a fun and momentous time. And Jason says that song never gets old. We'll go through the roll call. And, of course, Jason was the first one here, followed closely by Randall Ellison. And then Joe Reeder popped in. Hot Dog Andy from across the pond is here with us. And did I say Joe Reeder already? Nope, Joe Reeder's here. And Jack is also here with us. John Benicki. Hey, John, I missed you popping in earlier. And... Who else we got? Okay, I guess that's up to date for now. And we're going to go through a few things first. Of course, I do have all my supplies are handy and ready to be used at the drop of a notice. I got to check out some of my cameras here. Oh, that's the other camera on the other side of the room. All right. Don't need that one. What's this one show us? Oh, that's my heap of wires. And you can see the fire extinguisher there, of course. It's ready to go as well. I think
I think JB wants you to have another song ready, Burning Ring of Fire.
Yeah, that one would have been appropriate too. All right. I was going to get Smoking in the Boys Room. I even got it downloaded, but I didn't have a chance to get it ready in time. So, too busy with my multimeter running through and checking all of the connections and everything. Continuity and so forth.
Well, don't worry, Steve. Heath's here now, so you can blame it on Heath, whatever.
That's right. Hey, Heath, how you doing? you know, when we look at this and we look at the crazy amount of wiring involved, I'll be surprised if we don't have some kind of situation going on. You know, you figure there's 16 turnouts, three of which require two switch motors because they're double slips and a three-way. So there's 19 switch motors. Each switch motor has five wires. Three for the indicator lighting, which is most of what you saw in previous ones hanging down underneath. And I liked what I saw, what Heath did with embedding his indicator lights for the switches up between the railroad ties. And that's what I have planned. And thus, why I've gone ahead and ballasted. And I don't like doing that. I like to run for a long time, at least a month, before ballasting, just to work out any track issues that there might be. Mm-hmm. But I can't put the control board, this conglomerate here of electronics, I can't put it up in a way until I do wire management underneath here, including putting up those indicator lights up through the roadbed and so forth. So that's why we're have that the way it is. So 19 times 5, 20 times 5 is 100, so there's well over 100 when you take into consideration. There's also bus lines underneath. Mm-hmm. There's a bus, a parallel 14 gauge wiring for the switch motors. There's a bus line. Then there are three more single wire bus lines for the B rail of each of the three main lines, because this is, if you look, the three tracks that are ballasted are the three main lines. Everything else is sidings or yard. So, but they don't the A rail does not have a bus, because each one of those A rails is divided into three blocks. Okay, there's a block at the far end, a block in the center, and a block at the close end for this camera shot. For each of those three, and then there's also block detection in the yard and sidings. So they don't hook directly to a bus line. They all come back through a series of plugs back to the control board, to this block, this BDL-168, okay? And I'm gonna wrap this around a little bit, get a better picture there. So you can see all those leads under the BDL-168, all right? That does the block detection in JMRI, which that's a whole nother ball game once I get power to this thing. That'll have to work through.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
But of course, it's all protected from PM42, where you have four circuit breakers. So the layout's divided up. Each one of the main lines is on a circuit breaker. So as an example, this circuit breaker here, the first one, that one is for the switch motors. Okay. That's for the bus lines on the switch motors. The next one is for the far. Let me show you the picture. All right, it's for the far main line. That one, okay, which also covers the yard down there. Okay. Then the next one, switching cameras again, here, all right, that covers the center track. I got to keep changing cameras. That covers the center main line. Now, the center main line, before that goes from here, all right, from the circuit breaker, before it goes to the BDL-168 and its four zones, all right, it actually goes up through the motorman. Okay, because that center track will be automatic operation when I so desire for a train to be able to run back and forth. Okay, most, and I have, don't think you can see it in this picture. Yeah, you can. All right, right up here, you can see an E7 with two cars. One, the last car is just out of, well, it helps to change pictures again. There's an E7 on the middle track right here. All right. And then there's a coach, which is replicating a power car, which is another thing. And then a double-deck gallery commuter car. All right. So that one is set up to be able to go back and forth via the motorman or switch over to normal operations through normal DCC. And a throttle. Okay. Does that make sense, John?
Yes, it does. And we also had Grandpa Rails, JD, join us. And
hey, JD.
Bernard C.
Hey, Bernard. Hey, guys. Just dropped an earbud.
Didn't know if you'd seen him or not.
No, I'm too busy pointing and directing and changing cameras. So.
Yeah.
Anyway, that's that one. Then this track right here, all right, that is set up to be either programming or a siding. It's a switchback siding because you come into it in one direction, you have to switch back to it. But there's a double pull, double throw switch right here. That switches it from normal operations to a programming track. Okay.
Very good.
Then, of course, I got my my UR92, which is a duplex plug-in for my throttle, which I have up on the wall here. And let me switch around. We'll switch around to that one. So you get a face look. Now you can see the commuter train up there. Okay. And you got the throttle. It's just Velcroed to the fascia. UR92, which is duplex. In other words, it can go wireless off of that as well. Then, on top of all of that, you probably can't see them with this black. Well, yeah, you can. Here's a couple examples here. No, you can't see them.
They're pretty hidden.
Yeah, there's some flush mount single pole switches, right? And those are isolation switches so that if a locomotive is parked on one of the sidings, I can shut down that siding and not have the locomotive sitting there making sound or whatever. And it just
added. Yeah, I plan on doing that with my roundhouse tracks, having them all isolated so I can make sure I'm not drawing more power than I really need to be drawing.
Yep. So Bernard says he likes the breakers over the old light bulb days. Yeah, but and I do too. Dwight, welcome. It's not Friday. It's Bonfire Tuesday. Hopefully not a bonfire. Okay. So I've tried to explain a lot. And then I got camera wires running around everywhere. All of this mass of wiring and control boards. Also on the control board. All right, you see the command station over here. All right, you got two power supplies, one for the command station, which is a 8 amp, I think. and then a 3-amp back here for the behind the command station. So you got those power. You got two power strips. The one power strip's plugged into the other power strip, which is plugged into a smart socket. Okay. So I can tell the A girl when we get through all these explanations to power it all up, and then we can watch, see if there's any smoke. Oh, and then I forgot this little baby, which is the face of, until we go back to the shot.
Your mic is breaking up a bit, Steve.
Not anything I can do about it. I had sound problems before we went live, guys, and my sound is makeshift for right now. So bear with me. Anyway, down right here, if you can see, all right, is an alpha meter. So the power goes from the command station to the alpha meter before it goes to the PM42. I forgot to explain that. That way the alpha meter can tell me what the voltage reading is and the current amp draw.
Okay.
So the volume of the mic is too high, so it's clipping. Just talk soft. Okay, I'll talk softer. I think we're operating off of my headset mic because I couldn't get my other ones to work for whatever the reason was. Steve looks small. Well, yeah, that camera's way up behind me. It's a security camera, so it's more of a wide angle. And I mean,
it is what it is.
You know, do I look bigger now? But you can't see the whole layout when I do that. So, Bernard, a smart socket is a socket that's connected through your router and it's connected to the A girl, all right, who you'll see here in a minute. And my A girl is right here, by the way. Okay. And so all I have to do is tell the A girl to train. And if everything's set up right, this whole thing jumps to life. Hopefully without the blue smoke. What can I say? Somebody is playing around with.
Oh, issues. There was, yeah.
John, mute.
Hey, sorry.
Okay, I muted you, John. You done?
I'm done.
Okay. Yeah, I hear you, Heath. You want people to be able to make sure they hear you. And my wife always tells me I'm soft-spoken. I don't know where she's been for 40 years, but
maybe she's just hard of hearing.
I'm not going there, yeah. John.
Okay.
Yeah. I do have an AR1, not on this layout. I had it on 1.0 for my reversing thing. And yes, I had to up the sensitivity of the PM2s so that they didn't trip before the AR1 could reverse the could reverse it. So She just tunes me out. Yeah.
Selective hearing.
I don't think I ever say anything to her I don't have to repeat. Okay. It's always, huh? What? So I get louder. Every time I have to repeat something, I get louder. Anyway. And that all that does is piss her off. So
anyway. Heath, I want to thank you for your reduction code for Iron Planet Hobbies. They have gotten quite a bit of my money in the last 2 weeks. And I've utilized your human.
Oh, you cannot beat Iron Planet Hobbies with Heath discount code. I mean, all of this stuff, my PM42s, my BDL-168s, my PR4s, multiple of these PS14s, the alpha meter, all of that came from through Iron Planet Hobbies. All my track for my next little project, the speed matching layout, which will be really interesting once I get that started. But before I get to that, I got to make sure I get 2.0 at least running. All right. So.
And are you going to do videos on your speed matching table layout?
Oh, yeah. Yeah. Most definitely. Just like I'm doing on this. So.
Okay.
Okay. I'm just catching myself up with some of the chat here for a second. And all right. I guess the first thing to do, I've got the USB cord run. Let's go back to here.
And folks, he does have that fire extinguisher within reach of where he's setting.
It's right here, see?
Yep.
There's the PR4. And as you can see, I've got the USB cord run to right there. So the first thing we're going to do is plug that in. And see if you lose me, it means something was wrong and it blew up my computer. We have lights.
Yes.
We have lights. And no blue smoke yet. Let's change our angle. Do. All right. How's that for angle? All right. We can see the PM42, BDL-168. Because if there's going to be a problem, it's going to be right there, I would think. All right. What number to 911, right? you're so funny. Yeah, but it brings up a valid point. let's get the phone out just in case, right?
And Heath says, don't worry, nothing will go wrong unless you put trains on the track.
Well, the trains are on the track.
Oh well, he's already
train is up. There is a train on the track. But it is on the center track, which is the motorman track, and I have the switch set on the motorman to the off. You got motorman off or normal, okay? And I have it set to off. So this is a multi-step process. All right. So, I tell you what, I should have left my regular speakers on and let you tell the angle to power it up, John. That way it wouldn't be my fault. I should let Heath do it.
Yeah. Anytime we can blame it on Heath, that's good.
Absolutely. Absolutely. Let me zoom this out a little bit more. All right. The only thing I didn't show is next to this PR4, right next to it is LNWI, okay, which is Digitrax's Wi-Fi module.
Mm-hmm.
So I have the opportunity to utilize engine driver or what's the other one? The Apple version. Shit. Hang on. I'll tell you in a second. Wi-Throttle. All right. Without going through my computer system. But you can do that as well through JMRI and right. Panel Pro. So, one more check. Let's make sure I don't have anything across the rails. No, everything looks good up top. All right. Let's make sure all the isolation slit switches are off so we can fire this thing up in sections. All right. That's off. All right. Okay.
Are we ready?
Are we ready?
Are we ready?
White smoke, fire department in attendance. Ye of little faith. Like I said, I've gone through it over and over and over again. And in case you know, let's take another look here. All right. I mean, look at all these plugs.
It's a mess, Steve.
Well, it's not just a mess. It's a masterpiece in electrical engineering. Look at all these plugs. All right.
I don't think an electrical engineer would have been a little neater than that.
No, they hire somebody. They do somebody else. They just design the stuff.
Yeah. All right?
Somebody else actually does the work. But, I mean, it's a masterpiece. Look at all the plugs. See this? I mean, there's plugs everywhere. And I could have actually done this where we plug one thing in at a time.
Like Heath's unboxing. It takes 2 hours to get one box open.
Yeah. It takes 2 hours to get me to turn the switch on. Is that what you're saying?
Yeah.
Well, geez, you know. I we're only at 27 minutes, so I'm nowhere near Heath's speed yet, or lack thereof.
Yeah, more like that, yeah.
And another thing, you know, if I look up, let's show another picture here. Right here, you see that black wire hanging down right here.
Uh huh.
All right. That is the lead that will go up to a shelf, all right, where the power supply, hang on, I'm getting it, and photocell, this little baby, will sit on a shelf up there, and it will control the lighting bus. No, not the switch indicator lights. Not that. That's already in. It's on a 12-volt power supply underneath there already. This is for, like, building lights, you know, street lights and that type of thing. So I still have that yet to work on, too.
Very good.
So let's turn on, first of all, we'll turn on the switch indicator lights. All right. Now you can see them underneath there, right?
No, we're still looking at the top. There you go.
Well, no, it's not that. Okay. Hey, come on. There we go.
Now we can see them.
Those are all the little LEDs that got to go up through the bench work.
Let's see, green lights and yellow smoke makes blue. Oh.
Well, actually, on my wiring, I used blue at one end. And now, why does it do that?
I don't know.
I don't know why it does that. I'm just gonna have to live with it because I don't have another camera to change it with. It just started doing that. I don't know why. Oh well.
Jason's meeting with the real boss quick, and then he's heading to lunch. Is his real boss his wife? Probably.
You mean the PM 4? They're PM 42s. He's not 74s. I don't know if they do or not, to tell you the truth. LocoNet goes through them, so you can program the JMRI. So I would think if you can program through it, it communicates with the PM 42. So I don't know why it wouldn't.
Yeah, it should.
Okay, the 74 is a replacement for the 42. All right. Well, I have two of the 42s, only one on this lab, but I have another one still. So we'll switch over to this one, because this will give, if you see me jump up and away and grabbing my phone and extinguisher, then you'll know what's going on. Right?
And then if you see me sort of jump back away from the cameras because it's had an explosion there. And I'm just reacting to the explosion.
Yeah. So, yes. Trying to think, is there anything else I need to explain so that everything is in perspective before it burns up? You know, I'm confident in the PM42s doing their job. If it shorts out at all, any of the four zones, it'll get a red light over there. We shall see. All right. Heath wants to know, wants me to explain why this is taking so long. All right. Heath, I just wanted to give you a dose of your own medicine. And I'm sure everybody else can appreciate that fact. All right. So isn't 242 make an 84? Isn't 84 greater than 74? Absolutely, Bernard. Absolutely. I love mathematicians. All right. Now, once we get power on, then we have to step through a number of different things. Okay, so the first thing we're going to do is power it up. Pot, kettle, black. Yeah, absolutely, Andy. Absolutely. Is Jason back yet? I've actually been stalling until Jason got back.
No, Jason. Jason said he had to meet with his real boss before he headed to lunch.
Okay.
So that was my question: is his real boss his wife, or is he talking about a working boss?
No, he's talking about his working boss. He's at work today. Okay. He's off on Fridays, but he works on Tuesdays. Mm. So, with that, can I have a drum roll, please, John? Oh, yeah. Dwight, you know, brought up a point about the ship that hit the Francis Scott Key Bridge in Baltimore.
Yes.
What's that remind you of, John?
Sunshine Skyway Bridge in 80?
Was it 80? I thought it was 79, but somewhere back in there.
It could have been 79, 80. It made the Stars and Stripes when I was in Europe. So
yeah, I mean, it was almost identical to that, except the Sunshine Bridge was during foul weather. This one, the ship just lost power twice. Mm. And they lose power, they lose steerage.
And, apparently. You know, at least with the Sunshine Skyway, there were two spans instead of just one span that took down the entire bridge. I mean, it dominoed all the way to each end.
Yeah, I mean, it was crazy. Anyway. If you look up Tampa Sunshine Bridge Catastrophe, you'll see virtually the same thing where a ship hits the bridge supports. Now, what they did on the new Sunshine Skyway Bridge is they put huge barriers to protect those supports.
Large dolphins.
Yeah. Okay. Here we go.
Okay.
Ready?
Ready.
All right. You want the close-up or you want this far-away shot?
I think we'll probably be able to see smoke from different areas if you have the wide shot.
Okay. Yeah. Or we could go two cameras. Let's just leave it like that.
Yeah, you can drop me out if you want to have two cameras.
No. I could put two cameras on one. We're going to go solo layout, though, John.
Okay.
But you're still your audio's still there.
Okay.
So 10, 9, 8, 7. All right, Alexa, trains on. I see flashing lights.
Yeah, no smoke yet.
No smoke. All right. Okay. I'll move the camera around.
Yeah, you got that glitch at the bottom of it again.
Yeah, I know. Again, nothing I can do at this point.
Yeah. Yeah, looks.
Power supply.
Nothing's glowing red.
Everything's looking good. The PM42 is not tripped.
That's a good sign.
I got power to the motorman.
Mm-hmm. How about power to your amp meter? Should be showing what, zero? Well, no, you'll be.
I have not turned on track power yet.
Oh, okay.
All right. That is the next thing we can do. Ready for the track power?
We might get more smoke.
All right, we got track power.
Okay.
It is 14, almost 15 volts, which is good. And it's drawing 0.42 amps. Now, the reason it's drawing 0.42 amps is these are stall motor switch machines, mm-hmm. which means they're always drawing power. Okay. Mm-hmm. So, but a little under half an amp. All right. PM42 is still good. All right, our BDL 168 is got a green light.
Mm-hmm.
You can see it or not?
Right, just barely.
Green light right there. Everything's looking green. All right. Now the motorman. I chose this locomotive because before I tore down, Retirement Railroad 1.0, I put in this locomotive, 9916.
Mm-hmm.
And you can see the motorman is in the off position. So do we want to try the motorman out first, or do we want to try manual operation?
Why don't you do the motorman? Because that will, you know, that should, since that's isolated from your rest of your power, it'd probably be good to check that first.
Okay, good point. Valid point. As you can see, I have it set. It'll go to speed step 53, or what I have is 53.
Yeah, we can't read that screen at all.
Oh, okay. It's too bright.
Just white. Yeah.
It's preset to that. Okay. So we shall, and with the motorman, you can go in and configure this locomotive, if I'm not mistaken, is configured where it has two functions that are triggered at each end, a horn and a bell. So we'll see if that works after being powered down for so long. We're going to switch it over to motorman.
I hear sound.
Yeah, well.
And then it stopped.
Yeah, what happened? I'll show you what happened. Which one do I want? I want that one. If it connects. There we are.
Hi, guy.
What happened? It was over the sensor. So it wanted to go, but it wanted to go the wrong way. So let's do it this way. Didn't like that at all, did it? All right, let's take a look, make sure I have the sensors located, we're unobstructed. That one's okay. We'll look at the other one. All right. Let's configure down input endpoint delay pause on stop relearns direction. Yes. Select, change that to yes, save, back, yeah, okay, so we'll start it up, we're going to hit stop, then we're going to hit run. There it goes.
Okay, switch your cameras.
Why? It's coming back to you here. Oh, yeah.
We don't see it.
Right now it's in a delay. I think I have it set for, I don't remember. There it goes.
All right. No blue smoke either.
Let's make sure it does it okay on the other end. I cleaned the track as best I could, especially the ballast.
Mm-hmm.
Can you hear the bell?
Yes.
Now it should beep the horn when it starts in the other direction. Hopefully. Yep. Two shorts.
Very good. First piece of automation working.
There's the bell again. Oh, it lost contact.
What, right on a joint or in one of your...
It was on a... Rerailer grade crossing.
Oh, okay.
The joint's soldered at that point. I've soldered, at least on the center main line, I've soldered the joints except for where the block separation is, which is here. This separates here to here, and then here's the separation. So it's one side on the other. Yellow wire, green wire, blue wire. Because blue and yellow make green.
Yes.
Oh, I have a derailment. And I got a red light on my PM42, which is a good thing.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, all it takes is one fine granule of ballast. Throw these things off. So Hey, hi. Lost it again.
And is the where's your sensor at?
The sensor is
now at the other end.
There's one on each end.
Yeah.
All right, I'll show you. It is embedded in the track right here.
Okay.
And then embedded in the track right here.
So now, Steve, to solve that little issue, could you just move the sensor down farther so your train combination gets off that re-railer?
If I want to tear out a bunch of the layout.
Okay, never mind.
Because the sensors, train spotter sensors are about yay long.
Mm-hmm.
And to feed them up under and get them in there, there's a grooved out section of the plywood and then of the cork, and then it's built up a little bit.
Okay.
That's not something I'll do.
Okay.
I'll modify whatever I have to modify in the track. And it doesn't do it every time.
Okay.
So it might be, it could be some of the rosin that's gotten on the rails from when I soldered the things,
Yeah.
There's all different types of possibilities, but I'll work through that and figure that out. All right.
Yeah, because, when it stopped there, Steve, it only looked like the front truck of your engine was on the grade crossing section. So you should have still been getting power through your rear truck.
And that's if the rear truck's picking up properly. You got to remember, these things, all my equipment's been in storage basically for 6 months, over 6 months.
Yeah.
I got to clean the wheels. I don't know how dirty the wheels are. Yeah. I haven't had any place where I can clean the wheels with power until today.
Mm-hmm.
And it's not losing power every time.
Okay. Didn't lose power that time.
Nope. All right, we'll bring it out here to the middle and shut down the motorman. All right, so now it's time to use the throttle. And let's switch that line over to normal. And let's see.
I think it sensors are IR. Steve, is that correct?
I believe so. You can look up Iowa Scale Engineering Train Spotter.
I think they are IR.
Now, before anybody, before anybody gets too worried, down there at that end, switch sides, switch cameras. Down here at this end, I did install a piece of plexiglass.
Yeah, we can't see the end, Steve. It's
in
the center.
Hang on a second. We will swing a camera around. And
Okay, now we can see it good.
But you can't see the plexiglass.
It sounds like it's there, though.
It is. So I cannot run it off of the end. That's the point I wanted to make.
Yes.
I wanted to make sure. I just put that on late yesterday. I ran up and got some... Got some plexiglass.
And then when you do your expansion to the back end of the garage, you can just remove it and have
You and these grandiose plans. So it works on normal, and it works on the Motorman. I am impressed.
I am sure that everybody watching's impressed.
Now, what I need to do is I need to dig through and get one of my switch engines out and run it up and down every one of these other tracks.
Yeah.
Before I do that, though, I want to walk through each one. Since there's currently power to all the tracks, except the ones that are isolated, let's walk through and make sure all the isolated tracks are wired correctly. So I'm going to go through each of these isolation switches. Let me change cameras.
And Bernard C. wants to know if it's bullet train proof plexiglass.
I'm not going to test that theory.
Well, but you know, your layout isn't real long, so it'd kind of be a little hard to get up to full speed.
Well, and I have all of my locomotives are speed limited. All right, max that they will go is 70 scale miles per hour, give or take two miles per hour. Okay, mm-hmm. So I'm not too worried about that. Anyway, let's take a get this out of the way. I want to be able to see the PM42 to see if it trips or not. Mm-hmm. All right, that one's good. Which was this track back here. All right, and this one. Okay, it's good, which is this track here. This one is this engine shed track back here. He's good. Well, I say they're good. They're not causing a short. I don't know if there's power hitting them or not, but I need a... I got my meter, but I can do all that. Everybody don't want to watch that. They just want to see if it smokes or not.
Yeah.
So let's do the other engine shed one. It's good. All right. I've got... this one. That's good. This isolation switch is for both of these sidings. They're on the same block. All right, it's good. This one here is for this. And it is good.
And Bernard C. says he's certifiable abnormal Heath Section 8 all the way.
Then I've got my one that goes to programming or power. Programming. Whoa, that's fine. And normal is fine. And I have this.
High says to really check it, you need to have an engine across the two sections to check.
That's not. That's and yes, if I want to check that aspect of it.
But right now you're just checking wiring.
I'm just checking wiring.
Yes.
Okay. Because if I throw this switch and it trips the breaker, it means it's causing a short. And it's not. So I can eliminate that end of it by running through this test. Okay. This one. And that's good. And then the icing track back there. And that is good. All right. So, like I said, I should have gotten a switch engine and brought it out. We can do that on Friday. Or I can show, yeah. I'll have it done before Friday, but I'll show what, how to check them with an engine. Because I'll want to do it. So
are you happy?
I'm pleasantly impressed.
Or surprised?
A little of that, too. Little of that, too. So now I can switch back from normal onto the Motorman. I just think it's cool that when it stops, the bell comes on. All right, when it reverses direction, I got a program to pop the horn twice.
And that you were able to set up on through your JMRI into the...
No. That's done via the Motorman.
Oh, it is? Okay.
Yes. Good. The Motorman allows for two functions at each sensor.
Okay.
Okay. Like you could have, if I had an intermediate sensor here, I could have it do something else. But for a passenger train, it would be typical to ring the bell and a couple blurps of the horn.
Flying Crow just popped in.
Hey, Robert! We have trains running. No blue smoke.
Shrimp on the Barbie either.
Shrimp on the. I don't know that everything's working properly yet. I've got JMRIs on my computer, but I've not connected it up yet. So I'm sure that. And, you know, it's been 3 years since I connected it to the Retirement Railroad 1.0, so I probably forgot how to do most of it.
Yeah.
But for Robert's benefit, right now it's running on the Motorman. Just a tad. See what the track looks like.
Robert, no, he won't drop it off the end because he's got new plexiglass up at the end. And we've determined that it's bullet train plexiglass, so he can't ever go through it.
Huh, that's the second time it derailed there, huh? Look at that. But that did trip the breaker. I heard it.
Yeah, I think most of us have that problem, Bernard.
What's that?
Our bellies hanging off the edge.
It's an age thing.
Robert says it'd make a good video if you ran your train off the end.
Robert, you haven't seen the video where I ran an E-unit off of the Retirement Railroad 1.0?
I especially like the one when you ran it into the pit of the turntable.
Yeah, that was another good one. I did that more than once. You just saw it once.
Okay.
That was a semi-common experience. If I left that curve turnout on the main line open, train come barreling into the yard. Right into the pit if it wasn't lined up right.
Yep.
I got a little bit of an undulation right here.
You think that's what's doing it?
I don't know. God damn it. Let's see. May want to check my wheel gauging. Because that truck slid a little bit side to side. All right. Hey, Lynn!
Oh, yeah, I didn't see Lynn come in. Hi, Lynn.
Yeah, I was with him at the time. That was on one of his Friday live streams before he went back to work, and I think it was on his Friday live stream. But I sat there and just cringed watching it fly off, and I'm just, it was a steamer.
Joe, have a good lunch.
Hey, Joe, have a great lunch, and don't go over the bridge. I guess 7 cars ended up in the drink. That's what I heard.
Yeah, it's strange, Steve, that it's kind of intermittent for it to stop there in that location and stop running.
I think it is gauging related. I think the wheels are too close together. And it's allowing it to not ride on the wheel on the wheel properly, I think. So, with that, guys, all right, we've been on just over an hour. We had a successful test and fire up without the smoke.
And Hi just gave a little update. He won't have a live stream tonight.
Oh, okay, Hi. I never get to watch it live anyway, but I always get to watch it because I always watch the replay. So, hey, with that, I want to thank everybody for coming out this fine Tuesday morning, afternoon, evening, and seeing me fire this puppy up without any blue smoke. I still have a lot of testing to do. I mean, a ton of testing. I've got all of these indicator lights underneath that got to be pushed up. I mean, just a lot. This control board that's sitting here actually has to go up on some shelf brackets up here. But I can't do that until all those indicator lights are shoved up there. Now I lost it over on this end. I just want to see. Yeah, see it? It slid like a 16th of an inch to the side. All right. I'll take it apart and take a look at it.
Well, you know, some jostling around when you were moving it.
Yeah.
Could have tapped them in some or out.
And it could have been, it just could have been building up over time.
Yeah.
And under normal operations, you wouldn't even notice it. Mm-hmm. Overall, I am just extremely happy that it works. And all we know is that there's no shorts, and at this point, and that the center track works properly. That's really all we know. Oh, I do have two electrofrogs coming off of this front, the eastbound line to the siding. This crossover is electrofrog. So I have some testing, extra testing to do with those to make sure the polarity is
Yeah.
I think it is because I took the multimeter and did continuity tests, and it everything appears to be correct. But you never know until you actually run on it. So anyway. feels good. We started, I guess I started on this roughly January 1st. Doing the bench work and everything. And so here we are. My goal was to get it running by April 1st. Right? Mm-hmm. So I beat it by almost a week. So with that, guys, let me bring John back up here with me. There we go. And John, thank you for monitoring the chat and everything.
Well, I don't mind helping out, Steve, and hashtag not sponsored by Home Depot. Okay. I used to work there, so I got a bunch of free t-shirts. They're good to work in.
Yeah. Yeah, thank you, Bernard. No April Fool's jokes.
Yeah.
Although April Fool's Day is a bumper day for me and Michael McCarville. So you'll have to, we'll probably do something in that regard on the 1st of April to explain what bumper day means. You heard beeping, Heath. That's the bell on the locomotive when it is at the station, so to speak. The bell will come on until it reverses direction. Then it gives a beep, a horn blow, and it'll start to move, and it'll give a second horn blow as it takes off in the opposite direction. So if you listen and watch, there you hear the bell going, but it lost contact. So anyway, here nor there. Again, I want to thank everybody for joining John and I here for a special edition of Live and at Retirement Railroad 2.0. And y'all have a great day. Bye now.
See y'all.